O.J. Simpson.
Fact or fiction?
My kind of town, Chicago is. My kind of town, Chicago is.
June 12, 1994. 11:45 p.m., Los Angeles International Airport. American Airlines Flight 668, bound for Chicago, is cleared for takeoff. Sitting in first class is 46-year-old Orenthal James O.J. Simpson. A half hour later, at 875 South Bundy Avenue, LAPD officers discovered
two bodies lie near the entrance of this condominium building. The female victim is 35-year-old Nicole Brown Simpson. The male victim is identified as 25-year-old Ronald Goldman.
Police have not revealed how the two were killed.
Flight 668 landed in Chicago at 5:43 a.m.
Rules and regulations at U.S. airports were very different in 1994. For example, you were not required to have a ticket in order to pass through security and enter the terminal area. When dropping someone off or picking them up at the airport, it was common to accompany them to the departure gate or greet them at the arrival gate. That's exactly what Hertz employee Jim Merrill did on the morning of June 13, 1994. Hertz had assigned Merrill to accompany O.J. Simpson throughout his visit to Chicago. When Flight 668 landed, Jim Merrill was waiting at the arrival gate in order to connect with Mr. Simpson the moment he stepped off of the aircraft. The two men remained together until 6:16 a.m. when Mr. Simpson checked into the O'Hare Plaza Hotel. Pat McKenna, what were Jim Merrill and O.J. Simpson doing between the time he stepped off the plane until 6:16 a.m.?
Well, they obviously picked him up from the airport. They waited at baggage claim to get his bag. O.J. sat on a bench there, and they chatted it up, and as well as a lot of passengers that came up to O.J. and got an autograph and said hello. I think Hart Bingham stopped by, and so they were just continuing up with that, how you doing, and all of that sort of stuff, as well as total strangers. O.J. was always very easily approached and talked to and signed autographs. I think I had to report more of those in my reports to our lawyers.
Did any of the people who he signed autographs for at O'Hare ever come forward?
A couple of them.
Did any of them mention, his left hand having a cut?
No.
It's interesting.
No.
And they would have seen his hands because he did sign an autograph for them, right?
Well, yeah, he's signing autographs. He's sitting there with Jim Merrill and then when they got in the car, I think Bombay went back to Hertz or back home in his own car. Merrill took O.J. to the O'Hare Plaza. So I forget what it was just small talk, about the golf. Merrill's telling O.J., I'll be the guy to pick you up and I'll take you to the golf course.
Pat, a lot of people make a big deal about O.J.'s golf bag. There's a lot of connotations attached to it. Where was Mr. Simpson's golf bag? He left Mr. Merrill's car to go into the O'Hare Plaza?
They were left in the trunk of Jim's car, Jim Merrill. As I said earlier, Jim's going to pick O.J. up to take him to golf, so I'll just pick you up, leave your clubs in the car, which O.J. was fine. He's been on red-eye all night long. He didn't want to schlep clubs and his overnight, he had like a carry-on suit bag and I think a little black bag. So he just took that and checked into his room for a few hours sleep and then, obviously changed clothes to his golf or whatever he's going to wear the next day. And he wouldn't have to schlep any clubs around because Merrill would pick them up. So,
if you had incriminating evidence in, let's say, a golf bag, would you leave it in the hands of a total stranger?
No, not only that, but I don't think you would get on an airplane and fly across the country with incriminating evidence in your bags that could be lost, for example, or redirect or sent to the wrong city, and all of a sudden your bag is in Memphis, and now we hear this big story, and the Memphis cops could go, we got the golf bag, and get a search warrant, all that sort of stuff.
And this was 1994, not 1964, so there were metal detectors in airports that each passenger had to go through.
Sure.
And large knife that's bigger than a box cutter would have been detected because larger knives were illegal at that time.
Sure. And even that theory is almost, it's not our theory, obviously, but it's such an asinine, preposterous notion that O.J. Simpson would put a murder weapon in his golf bag, which could be discovered anywhere.
And then leave it with a total stranger.
Then leaving it with a stranger and rushing back, not saying, oh my God, I got to get that shit out of my golf bag. It's preposterous as you think of all this stuff. I mean, just the theories that were floating out there. And frankly, one of the more humorous things to me was that they took apart the toilet of the American Airlines plane, because obviously he went to the bathroom a couple of times and might have gotten some water or something from the stewardess.
Generally, when you're on a plane, does someone holding a large knife get noticed?
Yeah, usually.
Walking down the aisle of a large plane?
Yeah, you would think. Well, then remember, you'd have to take it where your golf clubs are underneath. So you'd have to somehow get into the cargo bin to get the knife out of your golf bag to put it in the toilet. I mean, just think this through.
Well, I did see Jack Bauer do that on an episode of 24. Yeah. I think it was season 6.
Just think it through. These guys, they jumped to conclusions and they were just pounding away at these crazy notions. But just that theory right there that the golf club, that he would have hid something in the golf bag. And by the way, it doesn't come back with him to L.A. Where are all these red hot, no shit detectives? Why aren't they on the phone with Chicago saying, hey, go to the room, you know, get the evidence, call in the airlines, have a security stop his bags.
And the airlines would have a record of how many bags Mr. Simpson checked on the night of June 12th and how many he checked on the morning of June 13th and discrepancy,
exactly.
Correct?
Exactly.
So there would have been less bags coming back than went there.
Yeah. And when I was in Chicago, I went to through American Airlines, got their permission and all that, to interview a couple people at O'Hare. And, of course, I was accompanied by their security, who was a couple of ex-FBI guys. They were nice enough to bring me down below where the conveyors are that show where the golf clubs would have come and all that sort of stuff and how the public can't get down there. So Simpson couldn't have got it down there either to get his knife and go put it in the field or whatever that other crazy theory was. I neglected to find out if there was airport video in Chicago.
Okay.
Which would have been great. And maybe there was, and that the government had it and didn't share it with us.
But you had multiple witnesses in Chicago who had interacted with him at the airport come forward on the record. So they would all have to be lying. They'd all have to be in on it. The people that he signed autographs for, Jim Merrill and others, would all have to be in on this grand conspiracy for him to have gotten around O'Hare and hid evidence.
Right. Yeah. Yeah.
So he checks into the hotel at 6:18, I think you said. Were there any phone calls made to or made from Mr. Simpson's room at the O'Hare Plaza Hotel after 6:15 and prior till about 8:30 when he was notified by LAPD that his ex-wife, Nicole Brown Simpson, had been killed?
There was one phone call. I think it was Caroline Goldburner. Call the room and see how he liked it. Is your room okay? It's one of those kind of things you do for celebrities. Is the room all right? Is everything okay?
Approximately what time do you think that phone call was made?
Well, in my notes here, I just located 7:30 a.m. Caroline Goldburn remembers a white female Hertz employee coming into the hotel and asking if Simpson checked in okay, and Miss Goldburn said he did, and I think they then called up to see if his room was okay and all that.
So we're looking at a window between 6:15 and 7:30-ish in the morning that if someone was to dispose of a murder weapon, they would have an hour and 15 minutes, which is a lot of time to be able to do that. A couple reports just talking about the murder weapon. On June 17th, 1994, the Chicago Tribune reporters George DeLama and John Fountain quoted police sources as saying investigators believe a blood-stained military-style entrenching tool that resembles a small shovel was the murder weapon. And then on June 17th, the Chicago Sun-Times' Bill Zwecker reported that an internal police department memo refers to the weapon as, quote, a samurai-style sword. Do you attribute O.J. Simpson's samurai skills to training he received from the late John Belushi in preparation for their sketch Samurai Night Fever, which was part of a 1978 episode of Saturday Night Live that Mr. Simpson hosted?
It very well could have. Sure. Just like the Frogman movie, there was all sorts of craziness out there in California that he learned the silent kill technique, meaning the way Nicole was killed, by a Navy SEAL who taught him that move in the filming of Frogman, which is about as absurd as him doing a samurai sword or a military entrenching tool. Not exactly Pulitzer Prize-winning journalism by those reporters there, I would say.
Are you inferring that Matthew Broderick couldn't stop a NSA, National Security Agency computer that was on the fritz called the Whopper and, you know, beat it in order to stop thermonuclear war?
You know, these things happen.
I was counting on Matthew Broderick in case we had thermonuclear war started by a computer.
Sure.
But now you're dispelling that with this assertion that Mr. Simpson didn't learn how to silently cut someone from the Frogman TV show that he filmed.
Well, it was either he learned it either there or he learned it from John Belushi in the sword move. But where did he get the entrenching tool training? I never heard where he got that training.
Just quickly going back to the samurai sword, to your knowledge, as we know, John Belushi died in the 80s. Did the defense team or LAPD ever confirm the whereabouts of Jim Belushi on the night of the murders, June 12, 1994?
I don't think they did. I don't remember seeing anything in Discovery with the interview of Jim Belushi or where he was that evening.
You might want to follow up on that.
It's a good lead. I think I'll get on that.
Also on June 17th, Chicago Tribune reported that an unidentified witness claimed that on the morning of June 13th, 1994, he was filling up his car at a gas station located at 5555 North Cumberland and saw a man fitting O.J. Simpson's description in the grassy area surrounded by trees located next to the gas station. Now, the June 17th edition of the Sun-Times reported a little more specific information about the alleged eyewitness.
Okay.
The motorist who gave Los Angeles police the tip on Thursday afternoon, that would be June 16th, was buying gas at an Amoco station at 5555 North Cumberland when he allegedly saw a man digging. The station is across Bryn Mawr Avenue from the hotel. The lot is separated from the gas station by a 6-foot wooden fence. Police did not explain how the man saw through or over the fence. LAPD Detective Bert Luper described the 50 by 100-yard lot as a mini jungle. And in the early days, he estimated that there was a very high percentage that they would find the murder weapon in Chicago, right?
Yeah, yeah. It's just the highest percentage that those two guys couldn't have found their asses with both hands. Okay? I mean, it's just amazing the work that was done by this robbery homicide group, this so-called elite group. And I could break it down as piece by piece about how crazy some of the stuff they thought up and followed up on. And the simple stuff like eliminating the husband, who's always the number one suspect, or the ex-husband, they could have eliminated him rather quickly with the same witnesses that I brought in.
Mm-hmm.
For the timeline and demeanor. Those people were all interviewed by the cop. You can look at their police reports and their interviews, and the same stuff that we learned, they could have learned. They did learn, but they overlooked it. They did learn that Simpson got his finger cut in the hotel room in Chicago,
mm-hmm.
Because they processed the room like a crime scene, so that there's photographs of the room. Now, we didn't get them all. I'm sure there's plenty of stuff that they withheld from us because we got like a million pages of Discovery, and there's some really cool stuff that they probably found out that would help us that we never got, but we'll never know because somebody told me they claim they've destroyed their whole file. Why? I don't know. Probably because there's exculpatory stuff in it. But anyways, I'm digressing here. So they could have learned all this stuff, and instead they're holding a press conference saying, I think that the weapon will be found here. Now, how do you know that? On June 16th or 17th, whenever he made that statement. You don't know anything on this case yet. What you have is
a
case that's already on TV around the world, and you have people that were in that neighborhood that are coming forward to say what they saw and heard and what time and with records, et cetera. And those people were all like put to the side because guess what? Simpson's their guy because of what? The glove that's at Rockingham. Nothing else. There's a glove at Rockingham, therefore he did it, okay? And Mark Furman led that whole damn department by their noses, okay? And then at the end, when they're all doing their books, they're all criticizing each other, you know? Like cats in a litter box, blaming everybody else for the case screwed up, but they all claimed they had the most evidence in the history of their careers to prove Simpson did a murder, a double murder. Forget it, just a murder.
Now, going back to the area around this Amoco station at 5555 North Cumberland, you were there for a couple weeks in Chicago. Now, this happened about 7 a.m. O'Hare Airport is in the top 10 busiest airports in the world. A lot of people are commuting at about 7 a.m.
Yep.
What was the Rosemont area like at about 7 a.m. just on a typical weekday morning?
Well, it was busy. You have the L there. Or
the Cumberland
train
station was right there.
Yeah.
Would one have to walk past that gas station to get to the L? And how far was it, if you recall?
I don't recall the exact distance.
Could you see the L stop from the gas station?
I think you could, sure.
Okay.
And you have hundreds of commuters that get on and off that are going to the train and getting off the train. So I would say it's very busy.
Now, there was this 6-foot tall wooden fence separating the gas station and the 50 by 100 yard field.
Yeah.
If you're pumping gas at the Amoco station, if you're at one of the pumps, whichever one is closest to the fence, let's say, how well could one see through that wooden fence to notice someone digging on the other side of the fence?
Well, you really couldn't. And the field is, like Luper said, a mini jungle. It was just a big field full of weeds and trees and crap. Simpson 6'2", so you'd only see the top 2 inches of his head.
But he was on his knees. He was apparently digging.
And he's bent over digging, so you wouldn't see him. And like I say, these Pulitzer Prize-winning journalists, they call it an anonymous source. Why don't you? And where'd this guy ever go after that? Why wouldn't he come to the police?
He's never been identified.
Right, never, because it was a stupid. It's
this anonymous witness. Here's his description of OJ from on June 22nd. The Los Angeles Times reported that the anonymous witness spoke with Dick Johnson, whose parents apparently hated him by giving him that name. He was a reporter for WLS-TV. Johnson told the Times that, quote, this guy said Simpson was wearing a touring hat and a golf shirt and pants. Pat, having no idea what a touring hat looks like, I Googled it, and the two images that you see in front of you both came up as a touring hat. Image A shows Mr. Simpson in a lovely Kentucky Derby hat, and image B looks like a cab driver hat that Mr. Simpson's wearing. Pat, in your expert opinion, which of these best represents the touring hat that was described by the witness?
Well, it's hard. They're both called touring hats. I guess the guy that called it in was thinking about the one on the right because he figured, well, golf. Let me throw in golf shirt and golf pants.
So but you're really, saying image B, you don't think it would be image A?
No, I don't know.
The color the touring hat, you know, looks good on Mr. Simpson. You know, darkens him. Yep. It conceals his appearance a little bit, although the flowers on top do stand out a bit.
Yep. And don't forget, if he wanted to hide, rather than wearing either one of those touring caps, he could have had that black knit cap on that he said that the government thinks he was wearing in murder. Okay, in a double murder, he put a little knit cap on. So why not just leave that on? If that's your disguise, to do a double murder so no one would know you because you got this knit cap on.
Was a hat box found amongst his luggage?
No hat box, no.
Okay, now this field that, because everyone makes such a big deal with it, continue till today, people still make a big deal with it. You hear, oh, OJ dumped the knife in a lake in Chicago or, you know, some field.
Yeah.
You know, it just keeps persisting. At the conclusion of multiple searches of the field adjacent to the Amoco station, they utilized metal detectors. And you mentioned the Secret Service earlier. The Chicago police actually borrowed tracking dogs from the Secret Service who were in town to do security for the World Cup 1994. The only evidence collected by law enforcement were a duffel bag and a pair of socks. Pat, what was the significance of the duffel bag and the socks?
I don't think there was any significance. Neither one. It was probably just in a field from a homeless person or something. But it's great to see how well law enforcement works together at these various levels. Here's the Secret Service giving the Chicago cops, who have the LA cops in town too. Here's some dogs, boys. Here, have our dogs for the day. And maybe some metal detectors. And wait a minute. Why don't you call NASA and get some satellite up in the air to look down to find metal objects?
That's amazing that you mentioned that, because on June 22nd, 1994, ABC News broadcast a report about the search for the murder weapon, which folks are seeing on their screen now. Sources tell Channel 7 that LA police are turning to high-tech satellite technology to continue the search. And what you see is very poorly animated. It was 1994. Yeah. Satellite in space beaming down to both Los Angeles and Chicago, and then the reporter goes on, those sources say the satellite is being positioned to focus on Chicago and LA and detect metal objects on the ground from high above in space. Pat, in the second and third largest cities in America, do you think the satellite would have been helpful in detecting metal objects? Because I can't imagine that there are many metal objects at, you know, one of the busiest airports in America, which this field was adjacent to, or in the city of Los Angeles. So it would have been obvious. They would have found it immediately, right?
Oh, sure. Especially, you know, they would have been able to tell a lot of that metal was, like, say, railroad rails, because there's a lot of railroads go through Chicago. And
you don't think the planes would have been set the metal detector off, do you?
Yeah.
What about the Sears Tower or the High Hancock Building?
I mean, just another asinine notion by law enforcement.
But I mean, the fact of the matter is, this was not like from The Onion or some Saturday Night Live skit. This was really real news reported by ABC that got past a fact checker somehow. That some satellite is going to go up and pinpoint in 1994, when they couldn't even get cell reception right, so you could hand off from one tower to the other. Right. They're going to have a satellite to go up to two of the largest cities in this country and somehow detect 13-inch knife.
From space.
I mean, you can't make this up.
I know. There's so much in this case you just can't make up. But, you know, what happened was it was such a media frenzy that it became, forget fact-checking. You got to get it out there first, because ABC doesn't want NBC to hear about this. So the minute, you know, some guy could be jerking them around saying, hey, we got a satellite we're going to use to detect metal in Chicago and L.A. And boom, they go right to the air with that, right? Without ever confirming or fact-checking or even talking to some, well, I don't know, some so-called expert, some retired NASA guy that could get on and say, yes, this is what we can do, or some spy person. And
so you're saying that the satellite was unsuccessful in locating the murder weapon in that field in Chicago?
Yep.
So
just think of that.
Now, you'd gone through the O'Hare Plaza Hotel. If OJ had wanted to leave his room on the ninth floor of the O'Hare Plaza Hotel to go dispose of evidence, what options did he have to exit the hotel?
There was two ways out. Take the elevator down to the lobby and walk out the front door.
So in the lobby, that was generally busy at about between 6:15 and 7:30 in the morning?
Pretty much mobbed with people checking in from Hertz and everywhere else.
And there were Hertz people there, but they wouldn't recognize Mr. Simpson, right?
No, they wouldn't have known OJ because he had that touring hat on.
Yes.
So he'd either do that, or he would have to go down, like I did, to just do some of my own investigation, take the stairway down, all nine floors. I forget, I even wrote how many steps it was.
Okay.
So that would take a while to go down the stairway, and then you would go out an exit door that you would have to have the presence of mind to know that it's going to lock behind you and you can't get back in. So
that would be a problem, wouldn't it?
That would be a big problem there, too. So now, to test that, the only way to test that and know and say, well, hey, if I go over there and put this in a field, I want to be able to get back in. Let me test this door here. So you have to go outside, close it, and you can't get back in. So now you're stuck outside this dumb door with a weapon in your hand, running across there, putting it in field, but then you have to come back in through the front door.
Pat, I believe that in one of the Naked Gun movies, they used a credit card to open a locked door. Do you feel that that's a possibility that he used to get back in?
Yeah, I guess. I guess that's always a possibility. That's what has to happen for that kind of theory to work, that Simpson went and hit a thing in the field. He had to get back in, so I don't know how he got back in. He had to use a credit card, I guess.
Do you know if that door was alarmed?
My recollection was it wasn't, because I did all that. I went out, and then I couldn't get myself back in, so I just walked around and
did you not have a credit card lobby. On you?
Well, I did, but I don't know how to use it to get into a locked door. But now an even easier way to dispel that notion, which is one of the things I found out there, was to talk to someone in the hotel about the security, how you get in and out of a room.
Okay.
Back then, you had these kind of like a credit card to get in your door, right? Like we have nowadays in almost all hotels. And there was, I think, a company called EMG Associates that I went and found out that they had all of these cards. Well, also what they have is in the door there is a computerized memory of how many times you go in and out of a room. That way, if for example, if I say, hey, while I was at playing golf, someone got into my room and stole $1 million that I had brought here. The security can go look and see if a maid went in there or if someone got in or out. And so you could also find out if OJ himself ever left his room from the time he checked in until the time he left to come out. And there's none of that.
And to their knowledge, there was no activity entering or exiting?
No.
Huh.
No, because he, you know, basically was in his room. He never left his room. He went to nod off and then he got the phone call and then he was out the door. He never, he went in once and left once. So there's no way he could have got out and dug a hole and buried a weapon in a field, which was searched by cops and dogs and metal detectors and Boy Scouts and whoever else wanted
to
go over there and look.
Don't forget the satellite.
And the satellite to become a hero in this case.
My kind of town, Chicago is.
For more, visit OJSimpson.co.